And hello, everyone. Welcome to a very special edition of the Gothic Graveyard Show. I am here by how I like, I consider an elder in our community, Oberon Zell. He is an author, a pagan wizard. He is a lecturer, a teacher, a artist. You, sir, have, I could continue this introduction and perhaps add a few more titles. College-educated psychologist, if I recall correctly?
Yes.
Yes, so you have been around the block a few times.
I have.
So I want to thank you for your time, and definitely want to appreciate you taking the taking time out of your, I'm sure, a very busy schedule. First, right off the bat, I've read some of your background and such, but for those who may not know you, could you just talk to us a little bit about how you got into paganism and modern day wizardry?
Wow, well, that's a lifetime thing. This is something that's always been my path. When I was a little kid, the very first reading that I did was children's versions of the Greek myths, and that just kept on going from there. The myths of different cultures, the fairy tales, the legends, the lore. It was all of that. It was the stories that inspired me more than anything, and I got completely caught up in the depth, in the breadth of folklore and customs and myths and legends, and that sort of inevitably led me into paganism, because that's where it all came from. And in many of the stories, the wizard is sort of a stock character. You've got the hero's quest kind of story. They usually begin with the wizard, the encounter that the hero has with the wizard, where he kind of explains what's going on and what he's got to do, whether it's Gandalf and Bilbo or Frodo or Merlin and Arthur, or Obi-Wan Kenobi and Luke Skywalker, or Dumbledore and Harry Potter, whatever version you go by, the wizard always has that important role of being the tutor, the mentor, the counselor. The concept of wizard really in modern times comes to us as the idea of the professor. It's pretty much the same sort of a thing, you know. So. And that, I just kind of fell into that. It really took hold back in 1980 or so, when I was first going out into the world with unicorns and doing Renaissance festivals. And you have to have a persona at the festival and a costume that's appropriate for the Renaissance. And the only one that really made any sense for me was a wizard. So that's when I first started appearing in that regalia. And people started referring to me that way. And it just kind of stuck and caught on. And I grew into it more and more, so that eventually became my identity and my life.
Oh, yeah. So it's a fairly organic process, if you will.
Very much. I mean, wizardry really means wisdom, and it's akin to words like, well, philosophy means love of wisdom, for example. So when you start getting into this, you find that the concept of wise ones, of philosophers, wizards, scientists, professors, all of that, it goes deep in human culture. And many of the significant people whose memories come down to us will be known in their time as wizards. Whether you're talking about the first one that we really have a good record of his life, which was Imhotep of ancient Egypt, who wrote the first books that we have on astronomy, astrology, medicine, architecture, just everything, really. And wizards have left us a legacy of books, of grimoires, as they're called, which means, well, our modern word grammars comes from that, as reference to a textbook. So really, wizards are writing textbooks from the dawn of time, and I guess you could say still are, because, that's the source of all of the books of instructions and manuals and handbooks and textbooks that we use today. I've written a few myself.
Yeah, just one or two. Just one or two.
Yeah,
which we'll talk about. Actually, that's a great segue. I got it right here on my shelf, the Grimoire for the Apprentice Wizard, which I will show everyone here. I consider this a great resource. It's a great reference book. And I know you wrote it for teens and young adults. As there's a few Harry Potter references and such, but as a whole, even as a adult, I found that book fascinating. There are certainly some aspects I found informative, and it's just it's my go-to book when there's you know, some chart or some symbol or something I need to reference. It's just a great book. And I if you could talk a little bit about the formation of the concept of the book and how that came about.
Well, it's all tied in with the idea of the school, of the Gray School of Wizardry, and the book is a part of that vision. Back in the very earliest days of my career in all of this, in the early 60s, I was, of course, inspired, as some may know, by the book Stranger in a Strange Land, a science fiction novel, which came up with the idea of a church of all worlds and presented some interesting theological and sociological concepts, quite a few of them, actually. Raising questions more than answers, which was the beauty of the whole thing. And so that was an inspiration that eventually led me into founding the Church of All Worlds, because I felt that at that time, a religious revolution, a new paradigm of religion, was really necessary. But I was equally inspired at that very same time by a comic book series that appeared in 1962, and that was the X-Men. On the idea of a school, Professor Xavier's School for Gifted Youngsters, as the comics and the movies have revealed, was also very appealing to me. And not only did I take every course available in college in comparative religion and theology, I also took everything they had in education and psychology and development, because that was also an interest. And we debated in those early days whether to start a school or a church, and we finally decided that the church was more urgent, but the school was always on the back burner. I got a teacher's certificate. I taught for many years at all levels in school, you know, from, you know, primary school up through college, and developed a sense of that. But there was Montessori education. There was the Waldorf schools. There was the Walden II, Summerhill. Lots of really great experimental schools were being developed, and I kind of felt that was covered. But I kept the ideas in the back of my mind, in this notion, and collected materials and built up a huge library of stuff. And the ideas just kept on percolating in the back of my mind until the Harry Potter phenomenon struck. And Morning Glory and I got called very early on when the first movie came out. We got called up by a Jewish shul in San Francisco.
Oh,
that they wanted, they have somebody to come down. They wanted a witch and a wizard to come down and talk to them about all this stuff. Right. And then they were going to go en masse. The whole school and parents and teachers and kids and everybody would go to the opening premiere of the movie. And that sounded like a blast. And so we went. We showed up in our full regalia. We did a great presentation. Everybody had a good time. And then we all went off to the movie. And there really wasn't any time to change. So we all showed up in our same magical regalia, only to discover that the theater was full of very short people in magical regalia. lots of little pointy hats around, you know? And that was my first exposure to it as a phenomenon. And the school had booked the entire balcony. So there we are sitting in the balcony with everybody else enjoying this wonderful movie. It was just absolutely delightful. And looking down over all these kids. And the important thing that struck me at that time was that the mythos had a shift in it. All of the other magical stories took place, oh, long ago and far away, you know, in another galaxy, or through the magic wardrobe, or somewhere over the rainbow, or someplace you can't get there from here, you know. But the magical world that J.K. Rowling wrote about now, it was just around the corner, maybe down some alleyway or off in the woods somewhere, but it was a part of the contemporary world. You might pass right by, you know, wizards and witches on the street. Mm-hmm. And that's true, you see. That's what made it really interesting.
We are, in fact, right here. People just don't notice us unless we go to a lot of trouble to
address attention. We're here. And that was a unique and powerful mythos. So the implication, as we're looking after all these kids, is that some of them are going to go wanting to look for the real thing. And it's available, sort of. You can walk into metaphysical stores just anywhere. There'll be notices on the bulletin boards about meetings and gatherings and things that are happening. You can pull books off the shelves. And the information is sort of there, but it's not available for kids. To get involved in a group, to get into any training, to attend a gathering or ritual, you pretty much have to be over 18 unless you're brought by your parents. And so we hadn't, as a magical community, been doing anything to make our stuff available to the next generation out there. So I said, I think we need to do something about that. And what is it that we could contribute? Well, at that time, our major work was creating altar figurines. We had a business, Mythic Images, and that's what I did, was I made altar figurines. And so I said, the first thing you do when you set your foot on the magical path is you create an altar, so we should make altar figurines for kids. So we designed a couple, nice young god and goddess, and went off that summer to the International New Age Trade Show in Denver, which we'd been doing every year for quite a few years, with our stuff. And while I was there, a friend of mine, Trish Telesco, showed up, and she was there with her publisher because she had just written another book. She'd written, 60-some books. She doesn't even know how many. So I congratulated her. I said, hey, Trish, good to see you. I'm glad to see you got a new book out. What is it this time? And she said, Oberon, you really got to get some books written yourself. When are you going to write a book? And I said, I'm so busy. I'm making statues. I write editorials. I'm publishing a magazine, running a church, all this stuff. She said, let me introduce you to my publisher. So she took me over to the New Page booth and said some extremely nice things about me to the acquisition editor there, Lori. And so Lori said, have a seat and tell me, if you were going to write a book for us, what would it be? And I hadn't really thought about it until that moment. And I said, I think I'd like to write a book that I would like to have as is my principle of doing everything. I make statues I want to have. I publish a magazine I want to read, created a church I wanted to be a part of, all that kind of stuff. That's been my modus operandi, is making things that I would like to have and figuring if other people like them too, then good, we're all together. So I said, I think I'd like to write something that would be like a Boy Scout handbook of wizardry, that would have a basic foundational compilation, a reference work, that would not only be the perfect thing you'd want to have as your first book when you set your foot on the path, but something that you would find useful for your whole life, and you'd want to have it right on yourself, just like I've got my Boy Scout handbook right on the shelf from when I was a kid. It's still useful. I still look up things in it. And so I kind of spun out this whole idea, and she said, that sounds great. Send us a proposal. Well, over the next few months, there were a lot of interesting synchronicities that encouraged me in that direction, and finally I did get a proposal off, and they accepted it. And I realized that, this is a bigger project than I can do by myself here, but I know all these amazing people. I know all the founders and the leaders and the teachers of all the groups, because I've been around for longer than anybody else, really. I mean, I started this in the early 60s. All of my contemporaries are now pretty much gone, so I'm just about the last one left of that era. But I knew all these people because I've been publishing Green Egg magazine, Yeah, I just happen to have an issue right here that I'm using, because this is also something I keep handy as a reference. And because I've been publishing this magazine since 68, I knew all the people who were contributors and artists and writers. So I put the word out and assembled a council, the Gray Council, the kind of legendary council we always read of or hear of in stories of wizards. And then put out this assignment and said, let's put together for the 21st century a basic foundational grimoire that we would want to have in our next incarnation when we come of age. And this would be the summation of the lessons and teachings that we want to put out for the next generation. Everybody thought that was a great idea. We spent 2 years working on it. And it came out at Bridget's Day right now of 2004. The book came out, The Grimoire for the Apprentice Wizard. It became an instant bestseller at the top of the list of New Pages books, and I'm still getting royalties, and it's been working really well. And in the process, we realized that, we really need to have a school to back this up, because this is a basic textbook, but there is so much more that could spring off of anything. Each chapter is only an introduction, and it really needs to be a whole school. So maybe it's time, finally, maybe the world is ready for us to bring out that school we've been thinking about for 50 years. And so we did. We started the Gray School of Wizardry, picked up an amazing bunch of teachers, developed a whole program and website and curriculum and the whole shebang. And that's going on 13 years now and been very successful. Wrote a number of other books to fill in the gaps, and spinning off of some of the chapters in the Grimoire became whole books to themselves. And just goes on. And that's how it kind of came together.
Yeah, and you had a follow-up book, The Companion to the Apprentice Wizard, which again, just added, as you said, the original book is more of an introduction, a crash course, and The Companion, I thought, was really, it was very substantive, I felt. It was some really, really great information. And I love the do-it-yourself sections as well. I thought that was really good. I think in a lot of subcultures, just not just paganism, but as a whole, a lot of different subcultures, the do-it-yourself aspect is getting depreciated, if you will, because, you know, when something becomes remotely popular, there's some mass-produced, things from China, you know, and I'm part of the goth subculture as well, and that's one of the ongoing things right now is back in the 80s when the goth subculture, the modern goth subculture, came to be, there was a lot of that clothespins and sewing, hand sewing, and putting your own garb together. Right. And now
there are, you go down to Hot Topic and buy it.
It's just, and I feel there's a lost element there's a little bit of cultural loss to these subcultures when the do-it-yourself aspect, you know, kind of gets brushed aside for the mass-produced.
Oh, I couldn't agree more. I mean, even something as basic as a magic wand, which is sort of the fundamental first thing to make in magical work, is you make a wand, right? How hard is that? I mean, you can make it fancy, but basically, you know, you start off by cutting a stick. And now everybody wants to buy fancy wands because they've seen Harry Potter. And we get students coming into the school saying, okay, I want to sign up for school, so where do I go to buy my wand? And I said, no. you take this class we got here on how to make your wand. And then there's other classes on how to make other tools. And when you get really good at it, you can learn to forge your blade and all that kind of stuff. But the point is, you make your stuff. It's got to be invested with your personal energy and measured according to your measurements and all that stuff. And it's amazing that that's such a radical notion, because it always used to be that, of course, you made your stuff. Where else you could get it, you know?
Right. No, I absolutely. I also know some, pagans and witches who they found some of their altar tools at flea markets, hand-me-downs, if you will. And, especially like chalices.
Yes, and that's an acceptable thing to do. Oh, yeah. Things like chalices and knives are pretty hard to make. Yeah. But finding them, and then you can engrave them with the sigils and your personal identity and your personal, signs and symbols and whatever else. There's whole lots of different traditional sigils you can engrave into them. And learning how to do the engraving becomes a part of the magical act of creation, too. But, at some point, while you can end up with a great collection of wonderful knives and wands and chalices and all that stuff, at some point you've got to make them. You can take a class in pottery and make your own beautiful chalice. You can take a class in blacksmithing and forge a knife. You can, and making a wand is really easy. But that's the thing, is learning the arts and crafts is part of the work. There's a reason why witchcraft is the craft. It's a craft, not just a study.
Yeah, it's also interesting in your book, you talk about the differences between witches and witchcraft and modern witchcraft and modern paganism.
Right.
And, on a skill set level, arguably they're pretty identical from a skill set level, but it's a kind of a philosophical difference, if you will, more so than a skill set. Could you talk about that a little bit, about the difference of the philosophy of witchcraft and wizardry?
Well, sure. Wizardry was always sort of more of an elite kind of a thing. It was, you know, professors and scientists and philosophers of the era. And whereas witches were a lot more homey, the hedge witch kind of a thing. Traditionally, well, the best way to identify witchcraft traditionally is as shamanism. It's the village shaman. Every village would have different roles. You'd have the village blacksmith and the village harness maker and the village weaver. And you would have the village shaman. And in the Western Europe, you would have, this would be the witch. And she would generally be an older woman who had spent a lifetime learning the herbalism. And, you know, she would have her garden. She would do wild crafting. And much of her work had to do with herbs. Mm-hmm. She would be the village midwife. She would be, she would put together spells. She would counsel people who came to her for counsel and advice. But she was not a religious leader. She was not a priestess or anything. She didn't conduct ceremonies for the village. That wasn't really a part of her work. And there generally wasn't a whole community. She might have a few friends that would get together for special occasions, like, you know, like Sabbats or Espets or something. But mostly, it was a very solitary practice, just like it was to be a blacksmith or something. And in modern times, with the revival of witchcraft in the 1950s, spurred mainly by Gerald Gardner, it was created specifically to be a contemporary religion rooted in the mystery initiation aspects of the old mystery cults. And so the combining of the old mystery cults, the initiatory mysteries of Attis, Adonis, the Eleusinian mysteries, you know, Dionysus, Anna, Hecate, all of these, kind of got merged in with the tradition of the healing arts and crafts. And so the modern witchcraft movement is a religion. Wizardry has never been a religion. It's any more than being a professor or a scientist or a philosopher is a religion. And a wizard is not a priest or a religious functionary, although many of the religions of the world were founded by people who would be considered wizards, or would have at their time considered wise ones. And but it's been much more focused on the intellectual and literary side of it. Witches were often illiterate. They very seldom would have books. If they did, it might be an herbal or a book of, you know, a handwritten book of spells that they would keep, that kind of stuff. But they were not keepers of libraries such. Whereas wizards tended to have libraries, collected books, wrote books, and passed these on down through the generations. We don't really have a literary history of the witches. We don't know, we don't have their books, but we do have the books of the wizards. And wizards also served as advisors and counselors to kings and royalty. Being the court wizard was a major part of the profession. They were also expected to put on shows, you know, magical performance shows. The art of performance magic that we have now is rooted in the arts of the old wizards from the earliest times. They would be maybe a pharaoh or a king would hear that there was some wizard out there and invite them to come to court and put on a show for people. Many people don't really realize that Leonardo da Vinci's main gig was putting on great shows with fabulous special effects back in the days when there really wasn't a lot else going on. I mean, we're talking the 1480s, you know, the Shakespeare didn't show up for another century. So, you know, so that's the kind of work. And so, but we all get along just great, you know. It's they're very parallel, simpatical kind of things. It's that's kind of why our life story, Morning Glory Mine, is called The Wizard and the Witch. We were just a team. It's a great team to have. And both of these terms are not sexually identified specifically. Witches can be men and women, and wizards can be men and women both. But the culture, the popular culture, has identified wizards more as men and witches more as women, and you get that carried over into things like the Harry Potter mythos. But really, that isn't really the distinction. And you can be both. You know, many wizards are also witches. Many witches are also wizards. It's just a slightly different profession.
Oh, and such as myself. You know, I consider I consider myself a pagan wizard, but I'm also Reverend Peter. I'm an ordained Wiccan. So, you know, exactly. So there's two, there's two sides to that coin. But I did, as you were kind of alluding to, the philosophy of wizardry. It's rooted in science and fact. That doesn't mean to say it's dismissive of the supernatural, the paranormal, or the esoteric. But we try to find that happy, the way I describe it when people ask me, we try to find that happy middle ground between astronomy and astrology, through physics and magic, through chemistry and alchemy, so on and so forth, because there is both legitimate things to learn from both. And and that's the way that's always been my takeaway of the difference of philosophy, where witchcraft is probably leans vastly more to the esoteric than the science, one could argue.
Yes, although the science of herbalism doesn't just include the magical uses of herbs, it also includes the medicinal herbal use and stuff too. And it was said that the first doctors claimed that they learned everything from the witches, because these were the herbalists, and they really spent a lot of time learning what blooms and what season and what it's good for medicine. Of course, the psychopharmacological aspects are important, well as the medicinal and nutritional aspects. It's quite a lot involved in that, and that was the speciality of the witches, was herbs.
Yes. In fact, when I was researching for a local self-published book I did about Salem, one particular etymology of the word witch, which I didn't realize till I did some research, is there's now a belief that it actually traced back, the root of the word traced back to the ancient Greek pharmakos, where we get the word pharmacy or pharmacist from.
Exactly.
Which epitomizes your what you're just saying, that connection between medicine and witchcraft.
Well, in the popular culture, I think that the best ways to understand both of these roles is to think of witches as shamans and wizards as philosophers and scientists and professors and so on like that. But as we've both been talking about, there's a lot of overlap. Wizardry has had a lot of focus on teaching, being the mentors and the teachers. The first recorded professional teachers in history were sort of famous local philosophers that would be hired by wealthy families to instruct their kids and to raise them up properly and teach them stuff they needed to know. And we see that echoed throughout the entire history of it. So that's an important role there. In a sense, you can just say that any teacher or professor is carrying forth the role of the wise one, the wizard, and so on in the stories. We in the school, our basic philosophy, what we consider the wisdom of the ages, can be summed up in a phrase that was written by Cicero in Latin, omnia vivant, omnia inter se connexa. And in English, that's everything is alive and everything is interconnected. And I still feel that this is just the foundational wisdom of the ages. Some of the early scientists of the scientific revolution, which occurred in the 1660s, Isaac Newton is probably the most famous, bridged that gap. They were both the last wizards and the first scientists, as you really think about it. Up and through the 19th century, scientists, the term was used for them was natural philosophers, which gets us back to philosophy, which means love of wisdom, which brings us to wizardry. So these things have all been interconnected, and this is what we try to teach in the Gray School. We teach wizardry as it would have been taught in that era, that it combines the metaphysics and the physics, the chemistry and the alchemy, the astronomy and the astrology. These things were artificially separated, and I don't think to anybody's benefit.
No, the separation, if I recall my history correctly, in the 1800s, it basically happened in the schools of England, the colleges of England, I believe. That's when the esoteric and the science got separated. And I've never been not a fan of that myself.
Right. So that's one of the purposes of the Great School of Wizardry, is to reunite these things that were arbitrarily divided, and a lot of babies were thrown out with the bathwater in the process.
Absolutely, absolutely. You know, I as a professional tarot reader, I get a lot of, you know, people, you know, they start talking, and of course, as you know, to properly read tarot, you got to have at least a basic understanding of astrology. And you know, a lot of astrology comes into play in a lot of my particular readings. And you know that a lot of clients are very taken aback when we start digging, not just the sun sign, but you start figure out their rising sign, their moon sign, and you start putting all that into play, and they're like, oh wow, you know, more times than not, most people are pretty shocked at how they see themselves in the descriptions, you know, you give them, or their emotional states, or their mental states, or what have you. And just to add on to what you're saying, I definitely think there's something to learn from both, and definitely separating the two was a mistake, you know, in the big picture. I'm glad that, you know, there are people like yourself that are trying to bridge that gap again. So speaking of talking more about your books, you did have another interesting book I want to talk about, the book of, let me get the exact title correctly, Creating Circles and Ceremonies.
Oh yeah.
And I've actually used that when I've done a few hand fastings myself. For those non-pagany witchy types, that is a non-Christian wedding. And I used that book. That was actually a very good reference for me. And I found it very informative. Could you talk a little bit about that book, how that book came about, and your thought process for that?
Oh, sure. Well, Morning Glory and I both had been, learning and studying and training lots of different traditions for our lives before we came together. And we had 40 years together. And during that, we did a lot of teaching as well, at all levels, both within groups as well as having formal classes at local colleges in the subject. And we compiled a lot of our materials and worked together. But the really important part of it is the 8 years that we lived in a big old hippie community up in Northern California with about 100 other families. It's a huge place. It's 5,600 acres. It's the largest, hippie community in the world, and still going strong. And we discovered that there were lots of pagans living up there, but people had come from all different traditions. Morning Glory had come out of witchcraft. I'd come out of the Church of All Worlds. Most of us had had a smattering of training and experience in other groups. But we had Dianex, and we had Nerud, and we had Alexandrians, and Gardnerians, and Mosians, and all these people from different traditions, all living on the ranch, and we all wanted to celebrate together because we didn't have any other group. But there we were, and the moon was full, and the season was changing. So we started getting together and sharing our materials and working out what was worked for us, and going deeper into the roots. You know, it's sort of like, well, you've got all these different things up at the top here, but if you go deep enough, you know, you find the deeper roots that they all came from. So that was kind of what we did with everybody. We kept looking for the deeper places that we were all connected. And we developed some very deep and very profound rituals and workings because we were living immersed in nature. We were completely off the grid. There was no electricity, no telephone, no TV, no radio. No internet, certainly, because it didn't exist back. I'm talking back in the 70s and 80s. And what there was the seasons and the moon and the stars. And we were totally immersed in this. You know, we lived a great deal of our lives were outdoors. And we walked back and forth to different places and created sacred shrines and around the land. And it was very much very primitive, very tribal, really. I mean, you know, we thought it was sort of like living in the 1860s or something. So in this process, we developed a whole new set of liturgy and cycles of the seasons and turnings of the year and mysteries and initiations that were really very, very profound. We dug deep into the cultural roots of the different cultures that we found attractive and that we drew from. And out of that, we developed the home tradition, Holy Order of Mother Earth is what we called it, H-O-M-E, or it's, we'd say welcome home. You know, a phrase that you now see everywhere, at every pagan festival anywhere, there's now big signs and things say, welcome home. Well, we were the ones who started that, really. And eventually, we felt that we needed to put this together in a book, so we started compiling these as kind of loose-leaf notes. The formal classes we'd been teaching, we had some of the other kids on the ranch would come to us and ask to learn from us and be our apprentices. So that's when we started getting apprentices showing up, you know. And we had to develop materials for them. And we developed a loosely bound version of the home cooking, we called it. And that was kind of the first beginning. And then New Page said, hey, you know, the two books you've already written, The Grimoire and The Companion, have become our two best sellers. We'd like some more from you. You know, how about a book of shadows kind of thing? And so once again, it was, well, what would we like to have? And we thought, how about something that was sort of structured like the joy of cooking kind of a thing that would be your introduction to the concepts and then a bunch of recipes and different elements and different things you can include so you can make your own rituals and mix and match the different stuff for any purpose, not only specifically pagan, but even things for a larger community. You could to do weddings and baby blessings and funerals that are not necessarily specifically pagan, but draw upon these deeper roots of customs and folklore, stuff people really are familiar with. They just don't know it. They just don't realize it's pagan, you know. Right. And so that's how it came to be. And it's also been very successful. That became the third most popular book on their bestseller list. So I've been having a pretty good record by this time, you know. Three of the top five of their bestseller books were written by me. And so they like me, and they're always wanting me to do more books. So we're working on that now. Right now I'm working on a book for Llewellyn, as they published the book The Wizard and the Witch, which I kind of felt would be a good one for them to do because we had a personal connection, Morning Glory and I, with Llewellyn, because we'd met at one of their conferences. And so I felt that, well, that would be a really good thing for them to do. And so they did, and The Wizard and the Witch is our life story. It's about half of it in the sense that the book was twice as long as they wanted it to be, and so we ended up having to cut it down to half of its original length, which leaves a lot more to be done for future stuff, and that was a lot of fun. And now I'm working on a book called Death Rites and Rites that will be in a similar vein to The Grimoire and The Companion. It will have a lot of material that you can use. It'll be a good reference book. It will also have lots of visionary and explanatory stuff and poetry and myths and legends. And a good part of it is the different afterlives of the different cultures, that what they teach about where you go and what happens after you die. So that's a lot of fun and a big project, but I've been way delayed in it by having major changes in my life and having to move, so I'm way overdue in getting the book to them, so I'm really trying to plug away at it right now.
We're Facebook friends, which you may or may not recall. I know you have thousands of friends, so I don't expect you to know each one personally, but I do, you know, I certainly do follow your exploits, and yeah, I did hear about that I guess it was I read you had a long post about how unexpectedly you had to leave your home due to landlord issues, and that kind of just threw all your projects up in the air, unfortunately.
It did, but well, it wasn't entirely unexpected. It had been coming all along. We lived at that house for 10 years, and when we first moved in, the landlord said, look, they really want to sell this house. It's a family inheritance, and you know, we couldn't get a lease. We were just paying month by month, but we got along okay with them. They were all right people. And after Morning Glory died, they said, look, we still need to sell this place. They'd been having, periodically, we'd have for sale signs up, and, you know, and realtors would be coming through showing people the place. It was always ephemeral. Didn't own it. So they said, well, give me a year to mourn and get your affairs in order after Morning Glory dies. And then really, we need to sell the place, and we're going to have you move out because we got to do a lot of fixing up. And so that was not entirely unanticipated. And when that finally came, then it was a matter of trying to pack up. this vast amount of stuff we'd accumulated, library and museum and collections and 366 goddess images collected from around the world and throughout history and so much more. And boxing it all up and putting it into storage and looking for a new place to move to and a new place to set it up took months. And we finally did, ended up in Santa Cruz, and opened up the Academy of Arcana that has a library and a museum and sanctuary, meeting place, and a gift store. And that's what we're doing right now. That's what I'm doing right now, of course, I guess I have to say. But there's always folks who show up to become a part of anything I'm involved in, so it's always a team, and I've got good people I work with.
Good. Yeah, talk to us a little bit about Arcana, if you could. As you said earlier, there was, you know, always this long-term plan of, you know, the school and the book and such. So I'm sure that was on the back burner for a while. But if you could just, you know, how did it finally come to fruition? And you know, what is it for those people who are unaware?
Well, the idea that Morning Glory and I pursued in our entire life together and came very close to achieving several times was a community, of course. That's what we really wanted. We wanted to have a kind of pagan community, something like a retreat center or a monastery kind of complex, but a place where a number of people could live and work together and build a life and be a permanent home and a place to be born, a place to be buried, all of that. That had always been the vision. We still have some of that in the sense, of course, the life at Greenfield Ranch that I mentioned before. Our church still has land up there. We have a 55-acre parcel, and we do retreats and gatherings and festivals, and that's where Morning Glory is buried. We were able to achieve a licensing as a legal cemetery for green burials, so anybody who would like to have their body planted in the earth instead of being cremated or something can do that. Now we have a place to do it. She has an apple tree growing from her grave, and her essence will pass into the fruit eventually and back into the community, and it's a beautiful ancient tradition. So we have that. So after she died, and we knew that I was going to have to find another place, that was the first effort, was to try to get together with a bunch of people and find some suitable facility that would work. And we looked at a number of places, and some of them could have served very well, but we just could not get the money together. We just didn't have enough momentum and enough resources to do it. That problem has plagued my entire life. I've never never been able to have the kind of funding that other projects like this have. You know, other museums, libraries, schools, churches, all these things always have funding. You know, that's how they work. And I've never been able to get that. You know, it's one of those little gaps in my life and in the magic. Although that could change at any time. I'm really working very hard now to try to turn the magic in that direction, because the current projects really are going to require patronage. You know, so we're seeking that. We're seeking that out there. We've got donations is up on the Academy website and on the school and the church for people who risk to support these efforts, like as other efforts are supported. But the pagan community, by and large, has not really been very good about financially supporting anything. You know, there's millions of us now, our self-identified pagans around the world, but we just seem to be really marginal in that regard. And I just guess that's the way it is, and I have to work with it.
Yeah, well, I'm going to be a little controversial here. I'm sure I'm going to get some hate email for these next comments. But I find the pagan community, you know, and when I say pagan community, I see pagan as an umbrella term, you know, Wiccans, witches, wizards, druids, Astaru, all these people under the pagan umbrella.
It's an inclusive concept.
Yes, an exclusive one. Yes, indeed. And I just find the pagan community as a whole our own worst enemy. Unfortunately, more times than not, especially when things like this, when people are trying to do good things for the community, like you and many other people in our community, and you know, they for whatever reason, pagans seem to be very, very reclusive. And, you know, they want to kind of do their thing. They just want to have their own little circle in the backyard and not be part of something bigger, you know, a bigger community, a bigger, I'm sure you have vastly more stories than I do, but just living in Salem, Mass for the time I did, I understand. It's part drama, part, it's like trying to lead cats sometimes. It's just a mixture of you know, these very independent, to some degree, overly self-righteous, self-important people. And it's just this mixture of all these elements, and you know they you know you hear the lines from some of these people. Oh, you know, it's, you know, where, you know, it's all about the earth and the energy and positivity and good karma and all this. But then when it comes time to, okay, well, let's put some action, put some resources where your mouth is, and let's do this. You know, unfortunately, all of a sudden, you see this big group of people all of a sudden whittle away into a much smaller group that actually does, you know, have the actions back up their words. And it seems like this is, you know, I've been into Wicca since 2000. I was aware of it before then, but that's when I really just had my epiphany, if you will. And it just seems like as far back as I can remember reading about it, and even after I got involved with it, this has just been an ongoing tooth-pulling exercise by the community, and I don't understand. As a psychologist, perhaps you can explain this to me, because it's like I want to strangle people sometimes. It's so frustrating, and I just don't understand.
Well, it is frustrating to have to be a part of a community, and in fact, to be a founder in a community that just fundamentally is not into supporting the community, to supporting each other, to supporting the people who need to be supported, because of course other religious communities do that, you know. Even some little dinky neighborhood church that has a handful of people, the people will tithe, they will support it. The collection basket will go around at the Sunday services and people put money in to support it. And we just don't do that as a community. And I think that the issue is that in order to become a pagan, you have to have a streak of independence and autonomy and creativity. It's not the conventional thing. Ordinary people don't be pagans, you know. People who are followers instead of leaders tend not to get into this. And I think that's kind of the issue there. You have to be fiercely independent, and you have to kind of fight your way through. As kids, many of our people, especially the women, for example, have had to fight their way up against parents, teachers, other people who try to just shoehorn you into their mold, into their thing. So, you know, it was like something that I think it was Groucho Marx who said, I wouldn't want to be a part of any group that would want me to be a part of it. There's this kind of a funny thing. And the irony is that I personally have tried to create things that I would want to be a part of, that are inclusive, that do embrace everybody. You know, my efforts in initially founding and forging the whole pagan community were all around that, all about trying to create a sandbox big enough for everybody to play in, not one that tries to keep other people out, but one that tries to invite other people in. And we have a wonderful community in those ways. I love it as a social group because, you know, like so many of us as a kid, I was a changeling. I didn't fit in with the rest of the social groupings growing up. So the only ultimate answer was to start my own, to start a gathering, a community of misfits. But that's what we are. We're really a community of misfits. And it's tough for us to learn to get along. It's sort of like, you know, that anarchist thing. We anarchists must stick apart. You know, we joke about things like herding cats. And we forget that a herd of cats is called a pride. But we do have pagan pride. And that probably is a spinoff from the gay pride thing. And I hope that we can learn some things from the gay community, which has had very similar and parallel struggles for acceptance and on a personal level, and then a group and recognition and all the rest of it. The parallels are really quite remarkable, and perhaps the enormous overlap between these respective communities is also a part of it all. But we're still learning to take care of each other and support each other. It pains me no end that so many of my contemporaries, the earlier founders and leaders of these groups, have died in poverty, unsupported, and their works are going unmaintained. You know, I mean, amazing people who had incredible libraries, and there's nobody to carry them on and to perpetuate that stuff. So that's what I'm desperately trying to do here, is to not allow the library and the collections and the museums and the artifacts. I've got the archives and artifacts of the pagan movement back to the earliest days, and, you know, in correspondences and files and publications and everything. And I don't want to see all this stuff end up in Goodwill, you know, or at the city dump. I'm trying to preserve it. And it's tough because all of my own resources, all of my royalties, all of the what I get from gigs and everything else simply goes into supporting the academy right now to keep it going. Right. So, you know, you will either find support or it won't. And if it doesn't and all the stuff goes away and all the collections that have been assembled by people going back to Gardner and his witchcraft museum, and if they all disappear when we're all dead, well, that'll be a great loss. And I'm sure future generations will
regret it and will wonder what was the matter with our ancestors that they didn't take any actions to preserve this stuff.
Yes.
And those are the people we'll have to answer to. I'm doing the best I can.
You know? No, I certainly appreciate it for whatever that's worth. And as I mentioned before we started recording, I'm a big fanboy of yours. Everything you do has always the best altruistic reasons. And I encourage anyone watching this definitely to support your endeavors because, as you said, it's about community. It's about coming together and being inclusive.
Well, you know, I've got like 5,000 Facebook friends and several thousand on LinkedIn and lots of other stuff. And I, you know, if everybody would pledge $1 a month to donate to some of these causes, that's not going to hurt you, you know, and it would really make all the difference to, you know, pick your favorite, you know, pick some group, pick some cause that you think is really worthy and just support it. Even the tiniest little pledge will, you know, with enough people makes it work. There's millions of us. We should do this.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, and speaking of the amount of pagans in North America, when I was researching my book, I found a study by Aris. It said, and this was done in 2000, this is down in 2008. And they said at that time, there was roughly 2 million people in America that identified themselves as pagan. 75% of them, specifically Wiccans, and all the other denominations broken up in the other 25%. But the interesting thing, and this is my point, is they said by the study and survey, they say that the pagan population is growing, where it's doubling roughly every 5 years. And now this is down in 2008. So if there were about 2 million in 2008, we're about, you know, we're more than 5 years later. So we're definitely, if that study is accurate on any level, we should be about 4 million now, give or take.
Well, yeah, in fact, and that's only in America, where we don't have religion listed on the census every 10 years. Mm. But in other countries that they do, paganism as a larger category, including witchcraft, is the fastest growing religion in all the English-speaking countries. In Australia, Canada, the British Isles, all the English-speaking countries. And it's really taking off and picking up in many other countries as well, where it's become linked with a kind of nationalist revival in places like Iceland and Lithuania and the Balkan countries and many other places. The reclaiming of their pagan heritage has become a huge event. Even in Greece, which the Greek Orthodox Church had outlawed the old religion of Greece. And if you were a citizen of Greece, and you were caught having altars to the old gods of Greece, you could be thrown in jail. But when they had to join the European Union, freedom of religion was a part of the conditions. And so now there's a whole pagan revival going on everywhere, really. I was down in Peru a number of years ago, and when people learned that there was a bunch of pagans down there, we had people coming out of the woodwork to telling us that, well, the place is officially Catholic, and everybody has to claim to be Catholic, you know, the pagan traditions are very strong among the people, and they wanted us to know that, not go away thinking they were all Catholics, you know. So there is this underground movement that's just going on everywhere of reclaiming in Hawaii, mm-hmm. Lots of places. And that's very exciting, really, because in our concept in use of pagan, we mean it to be the old religion, the traditions, the indigenous stuff, the classical traditions and all of that stuff. It's not just some, you know, modern contemporary thing. It's the rooted stuff that everybody had before they were conquered or converted or taken over by one of the monotheistic religions.
Oh, absolutely. Speaking of that, I read a article just like a month or so ago that the first new pagan temple was built, is it Iceland or somewhere in Scandinavia? I can't remember which country. I want to say it's Iceland, but I could be wrong.
I believe Iceland is correct. I know that paganism was actually established as a state religion in Iceland. And so, yes, it's becoming very strong there, reclaiming the old heritage. I love this. I mean, really, paganism is about reclaiming. I mean, we even have the group reclaiming that specifies that, you know.
Yes, indeed. Now, getting back to your school, for those people who, I mean, we've been talking about it this whole time, for anyone who wants to explore your school, see what it has to offer, how can people do that?
Well, like everything else I do, it's online, and you can Google it and look it up, or just Google my name and look me up, and there's links to everything. But it's grayschool.com, real simple, GREYSCHOOL. Go there, click onto that. There's an Enroll Now button. You can check out, without enrolling, the outline of the different departments and take a look at a syllabus for the classes. We've got 16 departments at 7 levels. We've got about 23 teachers, I believe, currently. Several applications we're considering. We have got 325 students as of today in 50 countries around the world, picking up really big in places like China, for instance, where
We've
got a lot of publicity recently. We had the Chinese Travel Channel came to the Academy last spring and filmed a whole segment, which aired in October in China. So we've been picking up a lot of that. There's over 480 classes available. We're developing and integrating a whole curriculum of classical education. We're developing additional extra departmental majors in specified areas, such as we're establishing a divination course, for example, that will give you a degree in an MDiv degree for clergy, for instance, which we had not had a part of it because the Gray School is not a religious school.
Right.
It's secular. There are lots of schools that teach magical subjects, but all of them except the Gray School are associated with some religion. And again, wizardry is not a religion, and we wanted to keep that distinction. So it's non-sectarian, non-religious, and we have students that are Christian, Muslim, Jewish, Buddhist, as well as the probably majority who there are pagan. But everybody gets along fine with mutual respect, as would any college of ancient times where people would go to learn the mysteries or the religion. If you went to school at the Library of Alexandria school in 400 CE, you know, you would be coming from all over the world, from all different traditions, and it wouldn't be an issue.
Right. No. Excellent. Now, you've done some... one thing I want to bring up, which I found fascinating... doing some research of this, as we talked briefly about before we started recording, you definitely have been one of the first proponents publicly of polyamory, and in fact your life mate came up with that term. Could you talk to us a little bit about your involvement with that and how that came to be, and her involvement in that?
Well, sure. like many people, really, she and I were both essentially poly all our lives. We always had multiple girlfriends or boyfriends, and when we were kids and growing up, and never really felt that inclination to only choose just one person to love. But there was no real identity for that particularly. The concept of the philosophical foundation for this were beautifully articulated in Robert Heinlein's novel Strange in a Strange Land, which came out in 1961 and was very influential to both of us, as well as to the entire culture of the sexual revolution of the 60s. It was a major factor in that because it promoted the concept that love can be defined as that condition wherein another person's happiness is essential to your own. And the discussion of that in the novel then flows into a whole conversation about, you know, the role of jealousy and possessiveness and why that really isn't a part of love and why love doesn't need to be limited to one person any more than if you're a parent and you got a bunch of kids, you can only love one of them, you know, and so on and so on. So we always embraced that, and we always had multiple lovers, and we always had an open marriage, and that worked out beautifully for us. We just developed a whole support network of family and tribe around that, mm-hmm. and kind of percolated that throughout the pagan community. In our travels, we would go to different gatherings and festivals, sometimes together, but more often not, and we would meet other people and hit it off and become lovers in long-time relationships. I just had a visit for a few days from a lover that I hadn't seen in 26 years, who was very, very important in my life, and it was just a wonderful reunion, and that all continues. So when we were publishing Green Egg magazine, our co-editor and third partner in our triad marriage at that time, Diane Darling, said to Morning Glory, said, well, we're going to be putting out a Beltane issue, and you're always talking about these rules of making these kind of relationships work. Why don't you do an article that explains what the foundational rules are for having multiple relationships? So she agreed to do that, and she wrote an article called Bouquet of Lovers. And in the process, it was necessary to come up with terminology, because there wasn't any. People's words were things like non-monogamy, which is, you should never define yourself by what you're not. That's just a stupid thing to do. You know? I mean, you know, non-monogamy, what does that mean? And people were coming up with words like, well, Carista had the term pan-fidelity. Polyfidelity, okay. which was good, but it means basically a closed relationship with several people, which is okay if that's what you want to do. Right. And then there was pan-fidelity that somebody else came up with, Michael Aluna, and there was omnigamy, which is a really obnoxiously stupid word done by a good friend of mine that I won't embarrass, which means marrying everything, which is really weird. Pansexuality, which means having sex with everything. You know, people were groping, but nobody really had a positive word. Right. And so in the process of discussing this, Morning Glory and I are both classical scholars, and Greek and Latin are part of our vocabulary. And so we said, well, let's just go back to the roots and come up with a word. Well, the Greek for multiple lovers would have been polyphilia, which sort of sounds like a disease, you know?
It does. So
polyphilia really didn't work. That's what that is. And the Latin would have been polyamory, which sort of works, but just sounds clinical and awkward. Yeah. And so we said, well, let's just combine the two. And it could have been polyamory or polyphilia, which didn't seem to be the right word. So, of course, we ended up with polyamory, which totally worked. It was immediately, you know, the whole concept is in the word. You really totally get it. You know what it's about. And she put that in the article, talked about polyamorous relationships, and we developed a whole glossary for that. We took it out into the world. We started attending conferences and relationships and stuff, and it spread. And it took off like wildfire. And before we knew it, there was this whole movement, and they're having big conferences and gatherings, and we're being invited to these to do presentations. And our family grew to the Ravenhearts with five people, and we became quite the darlings of the whole thing. We got interviewed, we got on TV, we got magazines, and it was just huge. And I got to admit, we were a pretty good-looking group, you know. It was really nice and articulate and lots of fun. And now there's a whole movement. Again, back to the Arlo Guthrie thing, you know. Just like the pagan movement, now there's a poly movement. And, you know, I'm still involved. We have poly meetups once a month here at the Academy for local folks who want to get together and meet and talk about stuff with each other. And we've done workshops and stuff everywhere. And it's just totally taken off on its own. And there we go. Bye, kids. Have a fun storm in the castle.
No, that's fascinating. As I said, I was taken aback when I was doing my research, reading up on you several years ago, and it lists, if I recall the article properly, it actually listed you as I don't know if it's the founder or a founder of the modern polyamorous movement, and I just found that fascinating.
Well, a thing like that, like most movements, has multiple threads weaving into it, and all of those streams leading into the river can be said to be founders. You know, they have their springs and their sources, and I've never really worried about that. But, you know, we were the ones who came up with a particular terminology in its modern use. I believe in continuing research, we found the term polyamory appearing in a few isolated instances going back centuries. So, you know, other people had thought of this before, but it never really taken hold as a movement. Same thing for pagan. The word had been around, obviously, for a long time, but until a bunch of people started identifying themselves as pagans, you really don't have a movement. I often think of the example and cite it of Benjamin Franklin. He was asked once, what was his greatest invention? And people were thinking about, you know, bifocals and the Franklin stove and the movable type and all that stuff. But what he said was Americans, because he was the one who coined the term American and started promoting it as a way to people to identify themselves. Before that, people were, you know, New Yorkers and Pennsylvanians and Baptists and Anabaptists and Puritans and Catholics and you know, Virginians and all kinds of stuff, but there was nothing that united them. And when people started identifying themselves, well, we're all Americans, that made possible American Revolution. And the same thing when I came in, there were Greek and Druid and Norse and Egyptian and witches and all that stuff, but there was nothing uniting them. When people started thinking, well, we're all pagans, then we could have a pagan movement. And when you've got a movement, there's many benefits there. At least, you know, it's harder to pick you off one at a time anyway.
Now, just two more questions. The real easy segue for either one of these topics. So, but I just wanted to know, did you ever get to meet or engage with any of the first or second generation witch, Wiccan, pagan people? Pre your time, obviously. Was there any crossover early in your life where you actually met any of those people?
Well, not so much directly. The witches in the early days were pretty much a British phenomenon. It wasn't until Ray Buckland came over to America
in the 60s.
But that didn't really catch on. When we started the pagan thing, we didn't really pick up any witches right off the bat. We picked up Greek and Egyptian and Druidic.
Oh, really?
And people. It took a while before we even knew that there were witches out there. And they came in the early 70s. Is where it came in, when I actually met Ray Buckland in 1972. But a number of Gardnerians that were initiated in that era were people that became friends of mine. The oldest one being Fred Lamond, who was initiated in Gerald Gardner's coven back in 56 or 7, something like that. And he and I became fast friends and water brothers, and he became a lifetime member of the Church of All Worlds and so on. And He's not doing well now. His health and his life is fading, and I expect to hear any day now that he's passed over. He's in Austria, and he just doesn't get out much. Mm-hmm. And Ray is still hanging in there and doing great, and we're still in constant communication, but he's not getting out much either. He just doesn't travel. He's up in Springfield, Ohio, and he's trying to put together a new museum, and we've been exchanging stuff for our respective museums. I've got some of his stuff here, and he's got some of our stuff there. Other people from the 50s pagan thing, Don Harrison, Harold Moss, Fred Adams, some of the early pioneers in that thing. Well, We knew each other. We were close. We worked together. We were good friends, and they're all dead. And so that's pretty much it there, you know. I was operating initially pretty much out of isolation because nobody really knew each other. I went to the same college that the Masters and Johnson were doing their work in Buckminster Fuller.
Oh, really?
Right, at Washington University. I didn't even know about them. I didn't find out about them until many years later because the different departments just weren't talking to each other. I wish I'd known.
That would have been fascinating, actually.
I know. I've met a lot of these people since, you know. A lot of them have sought me out from the continuing work in the foundations. We've had the people come and make connections. But they're the next generation of all that stuff, not right. The first generation. Right.
Did you meet any of the, you must have, by the 80s, you must have been mingling with people like Scott Cunningham and such?
Oh, yeah, of course. Yeah, we were all hanging out together. Scott was a wonderful guy, just this beautiful, beautiful guy. I so missed him. It was such a shock. He was one of the first people to go down in the AIDS epidemic, and it was a tragic loss. He was just such a beautiful guy. But he wrote some wonderful books, and they continue to be his legacy. That's a great legacy. If you can just write books and have something to carry on for people, that's the best thing you can do. What is remembered lives, you know. And I've kept the records for the pagan community, really, of those who have died since I've been here for such a long time and have written a lot of histories. So every year I provide the updated listing that is used for Samhain remembrances of things like the spiral dance and, mm-hmm. and in places and the wild hunt and so on. And it's tragic to me because I indicate by the color in my own notes those that I've known personally. And most of them I have, you know. The majority of the people who've died have been people I've known personally. And I miss them a great deal. And, you know, Morning Glory, of course, most of all, her name went on to the list in a couple of years ago. But boy, that was that year we lost a lot of people. We lost Donald Michael Craig and Margot Adler and Judy Harrow and Lorian Vigney and... It was just a huge thing. And we figured they must be having a great party over there.
Because they all went out at the same time.
And it was surprising. Like Craig, he wasn't really that old. I mean, relatively speaking, he was middle-aged, basically. I mean, I consider middle-aged. I mean, some of those names, it was very shocking to me when that happened.
I know. Well, I'm getting to be one of the older people in the community, and so most of the people dying are younger than me, which is kind of appalling, you know?
Yes, it is. It is.
I'm fine, you know,
well,
so
good,
far.
Good, good. Don't, so let's far, not, so let's good. Not, let's yeah, not well,
I, went through, I did go through a cancer thing, but I've recovered from that fully.
Oh,
unlike Morning Glory, who was taken out by cancer eventually, but hers was inoperable, and she fought it for over 8 years, but eventually it took her down.
Yeah.
And that's what most people seem to be dying of, is cancer. Yeah. I think there's this epidemic of cancer from the poisoning of our entire era. Yeah. You know, all the horrible toxics that have been dumped into the environment that have gone into the blood and bones of generations growing up in the post-war years.
Yeah.
It's tragic.
Oh, I totally agree. I mean, I'm one of the biggest proponents about the environment, and you know, and then we get people like Donald Trump elected, and that just puts the utter fear in me because he couldn't give a care less. If there's a dollar to be made, then let's rape and pillage the earth, and that's, you know, I mean, in the essence, that's his policy, and it's scary. It's very, very scary.
It is, and I hope that the movements that are happening, which are beautiful, I mean, the demonstrations just recently have been incredibly exciting and empowering. That's what we have to do. We really have to say, you know, we have to participate in this. We have to get together and stand for what we want to do and support it and get out there and not just wave around signs, but actively participate in activism of some sort or another. We can't just sit back and expect that everything is going to go along okay if we don't have any say about it. It's tragic that so many people didn't vote in this last election. Things have been very different if more people had voted.
Yeah. Well, the irony, I mean, the irony is on a popular level, you know, he lost. It was just the people who needed to vote in those particular states didn't. You know, the swing states, those voters should have gotten out. I mean, I can understand if you're in, like, my state, Massachusetts, or California, or Oregon, pretty much guarantee, you know, who's going to, you know, who on the ticket's going to win. However, on the swing states, every vote, literally every vote counts.
It does. It does. And, you know, I at this point, it's really too late to get involved in the politics. It's what's done is done. But I'm still really, really deeply angry at the Democratic National Convention people for screwing Bernie. You know, yes, I mean, he was the guy that we all wanted. And he would have beat Trump, you know, and he would have carried forth policies that even many of the Trump supporters would have liked to have had. Mm. But when it came down to it, many people felt they really didn't have a good choice anymore, you know, and they took whatever they could get and ended up, in many cases, voting for the lesser of evils, because there were lots of negative factors in both sides. It wasn't just a simple, straightforward thing, you know.
No. She
people
had a lot.
Felt
of,
torn, you know.
Absolutely. Did. She had a lot of baggage. There's no doubt about that. And
that's too bad. You know,
it is. She wasn't ideal, but my litmus test was she doesn't come off as a thin-skinned crazy person, which is unfortunately how Donald comes off to me, and that is very scary.
It is. It's scary to hand over the reins to someone that everybody perceives as a madman. Is kind of suicidal, you know, when we're racing along a cliff edge here, you know?
Yeah, it's, you know, we, getting back to what I was saying earlier about the pagan community, well, as Americans, sometimes we're our own worst enemy, too.
Yeah, there's a lot of parallels. There really are. And if we can't support what we believe in, then we are going to lose what we cherish and what we hope for.
Absolutely.
You know? And hopefully people will learn the lesson. I've been very heartened by the tone of the demonstrations that I've seen. They do seem to be a matter of reclaiming and seizing power and taking back the country, and I hope that that happens.
Oh, me too.
At least next time around, if not sooner.
Yes. I totally agree. Though I will say in fairness, Donald did have a very on-point comment to the demonstrations. Well, where were they? Where were these people on voting day?
Yeah,
I
couldn't agree
that.
More.
I can't dispute. It's very little I agree with Donald Trump on, but that I agree. I can't get on him for that. That's actually a perfect point to make.
I know, and when we lament the loss of our you know, founding people and all of the things that they had gathered in their lives, their archives, their collections, their all of this stuff that we haven't taken any care to try to secure or preserve. Well, you know, where the hell were you when this was coming down? You know, how can you let some of these people die alone in poverty? You know, I mean,
absolutely.
You know, and lose everything that they had. All of it ended up getting hauled away to the dump or something. That's been the history of our community, and it's tragic.
It is. One last thing I want to talk about, again, being the controversial person I am, I'd like to pick your brain on this. I don't want to say you're involved with it, but you're very astute with the Wiccan movement and the Wiccan religion. One of the issues that I have that I've gotten in a few, I've gotten a few scraps with, debates with people, is the British traditional Wiccans, the BTWs, and the eclectic Wiccans. And there seems to be, and this is actually segues into what I was talking about earlier, about being very insular and, pagans as a whole being all about, you know, what about me and, you know, so much for the community. This issue is just another wedge that I think we should look at, where the BTWs, just to be quite blunt about it, look down upon any non-BTW Wiccans. And while I understand, you know, you're doing your thing, but to get to the point where you're not even calling eclectic Wiccans, I don't consider them real Wiccans, or what I don't see how that's helpful within the ecosphere of the Wiccan community. I just, you know, the BTWs seem to go out of their way to You know, in the goth, I don't know if you're familiar with the goth subculture, but there's a gothier than thou phrase, which, you know, someone who's all into goth and they try to know every obscure little band and music, and so they can start just talking down to people and they can be gothier than thou. And it seems like these the BTWs, not every, I don't want to use a broad brush, but a good chunk of them seem to have this Wiccan version of being gothier than thou. And I just don't see how that's helpful. And I was just wondering what your you're taking either specifically within the Wiccan ecosphere or as a whole.
Well, you know, what to say about that? This has been a struggle of my whole life, is this restlessness. And there's always people who want to be in a group that will keep other people out that they don't approve of. You know, I've dealt with this on so many levels. The first Pagan Ecumenical Council that was formed, that I was a part of forming back in 1968, was the Council of Themis. And it was torn apart a few years later when some of the members coming in decided that they didn't approve of some of the other people and started trying to find ways of throwing them out and saying that, you know, we can't have you here. And it was just like totally missing the point. It's this is a problem with interfaith kind of work or community work, any kind of stuff, is getting people to accept the presence even of other people that are somewhat different from them. And this has been an essential meme in establishing the pagan community from the very beginning, is that we looked at, knowing that we were starting a new religion, those of us who were in the very beginning said that one of the most important things we had to do that had been a flaw in all the other major religions was this concept of the one true right and only way, the monotheistic monarchy, monogamy, monotony, that whole thing, that there can be only one, was a fatal flaw in the thinking. Because eventually, you know, if you believe that you've got the one true right and only way or truth, then everybody else is wrong, you know. And if they're wrong, well, then they have to be dismissed or punished or converted or burned at the stake or something like that, because they're all heretics. And virtually every group has a name for themselves that means we're the people, the chosen ones, you know, whatever, the chosen people, the master race, and then everybody else is heretics, you know, unbelievers, whatever word they use for that. These are the two terms that are foundational to all of these great monotheistic kind of religions. This is the term for the true believers and the term for the infidels. You know, and we can't do that. We just have to get beyond that. That was the whole point of the pagan movement. And there's lots of people that I have known and worked with and I consider dear friends in the British traditional witchcraft for years and years and years, and they didn't have that attitude. So if that attitude is creeping in now, it's a shame. And people who are have a deeper understanding of what we're trying to do here should work to clean up that in their own communities and repudiate it. We do not need to be looking down on each other and putting each other down and condemning each other. We need to cherish our diversity. Our watchword should be that. Like in Star Trek, the Vulcan Edict is the glory of creation is in its infinite diversity and in the myriad ways which our differences combine to create beauty and meaning. And so that concept of infinite diversity and infinite combinations should be the motto of the entire pagan movement. And it certainly works for me in that regard. And you know, we're all children of the same mother. We're all brothers and sisters. We share so much. What unites us is so much more important than what divides us, and so much deeper. And that's where my work is. And I'm not going to condemn other people for isolating themselves or being, not being able to work well with others or play well with others, because, well, that's their trip. And I just hope that they get better, you know. But like I said earlier, part of the process of becoming pagan is often one of having to stand alone against forces that would try to marginalize us or keep us down. And sometimes people just carry that, what I think is a bit too far, but they do so for their own internal reasons. I'm sure it must seem right and necessary for them to take that position. I just hope that they can get better.
Well said. Well said. Well, sir, I am so happy to have taken this time. I greatly, greatly appreciate it. Hopefully down the road we can do this again. I'm sure there's plenty of many other topics we can talk about. For people who want to find you, get in touch with you, get involved with any of your projects, how can they do that?
Well, you can Google my name, Oberon Zell. I've got a website just for that. You can check out Facebook. You can look me up on Wikipedia. You can go directly to caw.org for the Church of All Worlds, or grayschool.org for the Gray School of Wizardry, or Academy of Arcana. Google any of those things, and there's links to everything else. It's all interconnected, as I said before. And you can see what all I'm engaged in, and it's all a part of trying to move us forward into the broader pagan perspective of inclusivity.
Excellent. Well, thank you, Oberon Zell. I really appreciate it. And please, everyone, go check out his website. Go check out his projects. They're definitely worth your time. I cannot give him higher praise enough. As I said, he was the inspiration for myself to get into becoming a pagan wizard. So thank you, sir, so much for your time.
Thank you, Peter. It's been my pleasure. Blessed be.
Blessed be.